All species of gibbons live in subtropical to tropical environments, so they don't mind the heat. Shade inside the forest canopy shelters gibbons from the hot sun, allowing them to go about their days comfortably. And just like all other animals with fur or hair, the hair on their bodies helps to block solar radiation when they're in direct sunlight and protects their skin. Sweating is critical to keeping cool for humans, but our ability to excessively sweat is actually quite unique in the animal kingdom. This is because humans have millions of eccrine glands all over our bodies that produce a clear, odorless substance that evaporates off our skin to produce cooling in hot environments. Most animals pant to release heat, and only a small percentage of mammals can actually sweat. Most mammals have apocrine glands at each hair follicle over the majority of their body, and they only have eccrine glands on their paws. Apocrine glands secrete an odorless, oily fluid that becomes smelly through microbial activity on the surface of the skin. These glands are not typically involved in thermoregulation for the majority of animals, with the exception of some ungulates like horses. So panting and resting in the shade in hot environments is required to release body heat. Humans also have apocrine glands, but only in certain locations on the body, like in our stinky armpits, for example. No other animal has as many eccrine glands as we do, but other primates can sweat with high ratios of eccrine to apocrine glands all over their bodies, gibbons included. Chimpanzees and gorillas have twice as many eccrine glands as apocrine glands, so they can sweat more than any other animal, but not quite as much as us. And gibbons have a ratio of 1:1. So gibbons sweat less than us, less than chimpanzees or gorillas, but more than any other mammals like dogs or cats. And that's how they keep cool in hot tropical environments where they live. White-handed gibbons are likely the most well-known and well-documented species of gibbons, so it may seem like they're the most common, but their exact population numbers are currently unknown. Today we recognize 20 different species of gibbons, but early studies classified all these species into just two genera, Hylobates and Symphalangus, lumping many variations of gibbons together into the category of white-handed gibbon with the scientific name Hylobates lar. More extensive research over the last 30 years has revealed that all gibbons can't be lumped together into just two categories, and today we recognize four genera of gibbons based on distinctive number of chromosomes and their genetic makeup. These genera are divided into 20 different species. All live in southern Asia and all are endangered species. Gibbons reach adult maturity around the age of 10 years old, and for the most part, that's the time when they're ready to move out and start a family of their own. But at our study site, sometimes grown offspring will stick around with mom and dad for a few more years, or they may even move just next door. How and when offspring go is pretty variable. Occasionally, parents will become more hostile with offspring in an attempt to drive them away, but other parents are totally relaxed with the kids around and allow them to stay as long as they need to find a mate. Once offspring leave home and find a partner, they don't return, but that doesn't mean they're hostile towards family members if they do come in contact with them again as neighbors. In a few cases, we've seen adult male offspring come and go, leaving and returning for a few months at a time when they have not been able to successfully find partners of their own. We've also had a few cases where older fathers have left their original areas to join with their sons in neighboring groups. But it seems that for females, once an adult female leaves home, she's gone for good and doesn't return again. There are some species of nomascus gibbons that live in multi-male, multi-female groups where females appear to have stronger relationships with each other than they do in our particular study area. For the most part in our study area, males and females form strong bonds, and male lineages like fathers, grandfathers, sons, and brothers form strong bonds, but females don't appear to become as close with each other and as bonded as the males do. This is a tricky one. There haven't been any studies investigating sense of smell in gibbons directly. Traditionally, it's been widely believed that primates are vision-oriented animals with low olfactory ability, but this view has been challenged more recently. Certainly, primate olfactory systems are not as skilled as those of other animals that rely heavily on scent and smell like dogs do, but different types of primates have different nose shapes. Primates are divided into two suborders. One is called strepsirrhine primates, and they are defined by having wet rhinariums, which is the attached upper lip on the top of their snout. They have noses similar to those of dogs and cats. This suborder is made up of lemurs and lorises, and these primates also have large olfactory lobes in their brains for processing smell, indicating that smell is more important than vision to these primates. The second suborder is called haplorhiny, meaning simple nose or dry nose, and these primates include monkeys that live in Africa, Asia, and the Neotropics, as well as all apes and humans, and also small primates called tarsiers. These primates rely more heavily on vision. In the forest and in captivity, I've seen gibbons on rare occasions hold items up to their noses when curiously investigating the object, which would indicate that they do use their sense of smell when inspecting novel items or foods. But gibbons are extremely vigilant creatures, and more frequently, I've seen them looking at objects and touching them when investigating their environments. Thanks so much to everyone who sent in questions for this special Ask an Expert episode of Gibbon Livin'. If you have more questions, be sure to add them to the comments or send us direct messages, and we'll keep answering as many as we can. Until next time, thank you so much for helping us spread the Gibbon love by liking and sharing this video with all your friends and joining the movement to let the world know the small apes are just as great as the big ones.